So, tell me if this gets too irritating and burning my head, or doing any of the other things that you'll do when you have to hold a mic to your face. I took a little bit of a different approach to this presentation. I've done a couple of Spark talks already, and the last one I gave, the feedback was kind of who runs Bartertown? Master Bats, Blaster runs Bartertown, so everybody kind of knew what I was going to say, right? So you've been out to the Apache Spark site, great documentation on the API, great documentation on how to get up and running, fabulous place to look if you want to just start play with it on, I hesitate to say any operating system in this type of crowd, but the primary operating systems that are out there, and that includes BSD. So it's not hard to get running. That development experience, I think, is probably what's lending to it kind of catching like fire like it is. The other piece to that, and I'll get into that in a bit here, is it's very simple. It's not like the MapR-DB paradigm that you have with Hadoop and Java. So anyway, since everybody kind of knew what I was going to say when I started talking speeds and feeds and APIs and RDDs and DAGs and broadcast variables and all those pieces and accumulators and whatever else, I decided to take a different approach. So I crafted a new presentation for when people ask me to talk about Spark. And this one is more use case driven. Actually, last time I sat down with Mike Siegel and Jim, this has been a few months ago, they had said, you know, why don't you speak at the Chugs more? And I'm kind of like, well, every time I show up at a Chug and I speak about an API that's interesting and that we've done something with, everybody kind of looks at me after the Chug and says, hey Mike, that was great, but next time we'd like to hear you talk about use cases. So I tended not to show up to the Chugs. And so Mike's like, well, why don't you show up and do a use case talk sometime? I'm like, all right, well, that kind of makes sense, right? Because everybody in this room can go to the Spark site and look at the API information and play with it and play with Spark. Not everybody in this room gets to go to talk to, you know, 15, 16 people a week who are trying to build out their new Hadoop infrastructure, right? And so it's kind of one of the unique positions as being one of the major vendors in the space is that we get to see what everybody's doing with Hadoop, right, wrong, or otherwise, right? So that's really what this is focused on. So it's kind of a progression, and you'll pick that up as we go through here. The use cases I cover in general are the log file enrichment, ETL with machine learning, which is kind of a new piece that's coming just from Spark. The log file enrichment or data metadata enrichment piece is something that more and more people are doing now. It's actually something that I've seen kind of with a market uptick since people started picking up Spark, and we'll talk more about that, why that is a little later. Recommendation engine and ad hoc SQL queries. These are in no particular order on the front slide. I actually intentionally put them out of order to prevent anybody from picking off my progression too soon. And then the future case. So we talk about the year 2000 situation, right? So who am I? I've been an architect at MapR for about 2.5 years. Before that, I was actually at IBM. Did a little bit of work on that Watson project. And then saw that, you know, maybe the Watson strategy maybe wasn't the greatest from the Hadoop space. And so I went and looked at all the players in the game at the time, which wasn't many, and decided that MapR was the place I wanted to be. I actually logged most of my creative hours out of Workshop 88 in the burbs. Go Hackerspaces. Any other Hackerspace members in here? Anyone? Anyone? No. All right. So yeah, I spend most of my time out there. We do everything from we're actually starting to think about some Hadoop classes now. We do a lot of Arduino classes. You know, you name it, hackery in nature, we do it out there. So certainly check us out. And you can actually keep your eyes on our website if we decide to do our Hadoop classes out there. We're thinking about actually Spark and HBase type stuff. Maybe some Hivepig type stuff as well, though my argument is those are a little passe, but I'm the only one at a vendor at Workshop 88, so my view of passe and everybody else's maybe a little different. So anyway, that's me. Keep an eye on workshop88.com if you are interested in potentially checking out some classes. So again, my approach to this presentation was a little different. It was an architecture approach. And so there's not really an API discussion here. I'll make a few references to some things. May talk about why a particular API feature set is being used to accomplish something, but it's not by any means the focus of the conversation here. Setup is not the focus of the conversation here, and certainly architecting a large-scale Spark implementation is not the focus of the conversation here. Happy to do that one-on-one or invite you back. So it'll be architectures, features, utilization, and then the use cases and why Spark specifically, right? And I spoke a little bit about that earlier. So again, 10,000 feet of Spark, right? Fundamentally an MPP. Did anybody in here not know that it was an MPP? That's cool. That's good. I'm curious because it actually doesn't call it an MPP on the Spark, Apache Spark website anywhere that I've found. I think it was maybe in there at one point. I think it's been pulled down now. But it's actually not on the Spark site at any point now. It's an in-memory MPP that specifically uses a MapReduce paradigm. So the RDDs here, actually resilient distributed data sets, they're pretty much like the DAGs that we're used to iterating on in the Hadoop space, right? It can use any storage subsystem. I put that up there, like I said earlier, because it's a great way to kind of get started with it. You can use any major operating system and BSD, again, underneath it. So very quick and easy to get started with. It's actually kind of interesting. I'm seeing some people already starting to talk about embedding it in other use cases. And kind of, it's kind of like people did with Couchbase back in the day. I say that like Couchbase has been around for eons, but. But yeah, and you're seeing that now with Elasticsearch and Solr as well. People are starting to put it in kind of an embedded nature, much like you used to see SQLite or even small MySQL instances on servers as well. Three major kind of components that you work with in Spark: RDDs, accumulators, and your broadcast variables. Accumulators is kind of like a reducer function that pulls everything in. It's said it accumulates. Broadcast is kind of something that you shout out from any one of the Spark worker nodes and everybody can listen to it, right? So it's kind of a distinctly one-way type of communication, right? One is one too many and the other is many to one, right? So you kind of see how that might fit in with the MapReduce paradigm. It is, in fact, MapReduce Plus. So you are starting to see, the reason I always bring that up is specifically when we get into MLlib, and the future of MLlib, you'll start to see some things that you can do with the MPP and Spark that you can't do with Hadoop today. Right? One of the big kind of limiters that we see when we've had Ted in here to speak before, when you talk about Mahout or when you talk about other machine learning type capabilities, is there's an inability to have kind of a near-time messaging system, right? With Spark, you start to see some capability around that. So with some creativity, some from the mathletes in the room, I'm sure that we'll start to see a broader use case for MLlib and more and newer algorithms we don't have access to today. Again, great resources on the Apache Spark site. What's kind of cool is they keep all the old stuff up out there too. And you'll actually see people on the West Coast speaking about Spark as they've been using it for 2.5, 2 years now, right? And while we've known about it at MapR for that long and been working with AmpLab on it for that long, certainly, aside from kind of West Coast-y type customers, there's nobody been brave enough to be using it that long. MapR, just speaking from my vendor standpoint, and something I probably should have said in the slide earlier, is I'll speak on what I know and what I see in the industry. Purely from me being at MapR, right? I can't speak to what the other guys might be seeing, but from what I see, we do have customers in production with it, using it today. And when we go through and get to those points, I'll highlight what they're using. I actually can't speak about who the customers are, but I can't speak to exactly what they're accomplishing. And it's early in their iteration. So the use case is, SQL queries. Just like we started out with Hive, you first see people moving over to Spark to get that ad hoc SQL nature, right? And who here, the first thing they heard about Spark was this ad hoc SQL capability. So two people and the rest of you are shy? Or is that kind of what it is? Because seriously, probably a solid 85% of our customer base asked about Spark, and the first thing they asked about was Shark, right? Which is essentially Hive running on Shark, Hive running on RDBs sitting on top. And significant speed up. I won't talk about benchmarks because I'm at a vendor. If you want to talk about the receive the benchmarks comparing Spark to Tez and some of the other projects that are out there that are actually supported by the other vendors, why I don't talk about them. You can go out to the Apache Spark site or go out to the Databricks site. And they actually go in detail about the benchmarks they did, why they did the benchmarks, how they did the benchmarks, and then how those other utilities and tools stack up, right? But you know, some of the other utilities and tools are absolutely here. Impala Grill, Apache Grill, which is actually MapR's, which I'll mention at the end, going into beta later this month if anybody wants to play with it. Great time to get engaged. Hive, Hawk, which probably nobody in here has had the privilege of working with since yet. Oh, there we go. I think you either have to be a debutante on EMC or a trusted member of their inner circle to get access to it at this point. And then Shark. And every time I talk about all the SQL tools or Hadoop ecosystem pieces, I have a customer mention the animal farm of Hadoop. So I decided to dedicate an icon to it. I'm also a big Orwell fan, so if anybody else wants to use it, it's just a cover art of obviously one of his animal farm books. So anyway, as I mentioned, native SQL or native HiveQL, which if anybody doesn't know, HiveQL is SQL 93-ish, so it's still a fairly remedial SQL. In-memory and from disk, this is a common question we get, because Impala, which was the first entrance into the market in that space of kind of doing in-memory SQL on Hadoop with the HQL interface, was all in-memory as well, but it couldn't go to disk very effectively, and it had problems with doing joints that were larger than in-memory. You don't have that problem with Spark. It's functional today. It does it today. It does it well today. And outperforms, you know, the other SQL things that are essentially Hive on YARN that I didn't put up here, which is Tez and Singer type stuff, right? And as I mentioned, usually the first thought, the two customers that we have, this is exactly what they're doing. They've actually taken some of their legacy, larger workloads that they were struggling with, whether it was Teradata or Netezza or whatever their enterprise data workload was, and they moved it into Shark on top of Spark, and they're running it in production today. Are there any questions? Usually I get the question right away, well, what are they running it on? What's it look like? How's it, you know, how are they doing that? How's their support? They're actually running on Mesos, and I don't know, it depends on your level of indoctrination to the Shark community. There's a Shark divide in the Shark Spark community about whether Databricks and Labs should have ported Spark to run it on YARN. Initially, and in fact still today, it uses internally the Mesos libraries to do a lot of its resource management, and it was kind of only a recent afterthought that it was moved over to run on YARN. I want to say that was maybe about 6-8 months ago that they did that. Now, that's not to say that it was done ad hoc or that it's, you know, a half effort at all. They did it well. It runs well on YARN, but it wasn't the initial kind of way that you see it running, right? So when you hear, or if you go out to the Apache Spark site, nobody that's running it is actually running it with YARN because it wasn't ever intended to run with YARN. So as we move forward in the future, as YARN develops, as Spark develops, we'll probably start seeing some customers using it in that format. And you know, there's different multi-tenants between what you see in Mesos and what you see in YARN. So we'll have to see how things shake out on that front. So I kind of dropped these broader architecture slides in here just so I can kind of talk to. And with an ad hoc SQL query, there's really not much, right? The data needs to be ingested. And I'm going to talk primarily about log files and just for example. So the data needs to be ingested. So data is coming in from somewhere that can be ingested via a standard Hadoop methodology, Flume, Scoop. For most of our customers, it's not that way, but you know, that's a MapR differentiator, right? So we'll leave it that. So the data is coming in. In this case, we'd be using Spark Streaming. The production customers that I have today are not actually using Spark Streaming to ingest. They're using one of the MapR specific features, NFS, to ingest. And then they're just using Spark. I circled NoSQL, but the Spark SQL tools to kind of do a presentation piece. They're not using any one of the visualization layers that you see here. We have folks looking at and evaluating that. Is that a little tough to read? I wasn't sure how it would present.
Was that Tableau ClickView?
Yeah, Tableau ClickView and MicroStrategy is this layer right in here, just kind of a visualization layer. These are more data products or in customer solutions. And to be honest, like I said, this is kind of crafted towards a log file use case, but I'll be speaking about these kind of generally, and you'll understand here in a bit why. But yeah, so right now today, they're just basically dumping data in, and they're querying it with Shark. Not much different than probably everybody in the room did for an early trial of Hive, right? You got a little bit of data, you threw it in, crafted a quick select all, and it returned, and you were like, all right, I'm off the races, right? They're doing a little more than that, obviously. They're delivering a data product back to a web interface. The web interface doesn't query it, but the data product is actually hit directly as it sits in Hadoop. In this case here, I've got an M7 persistence layer. We'll talk about more about that layer later. M7 or NoSQL or age-based persistence layer, we can kind of visualize that. Yeah? So how are they accessing HDFS files if they're running on Mesos? In my case, Mesos runs on top of MapR and it presents just
that's
yeah.
But
so
if somebody is using, for example, yeah, I know you can get to a file there.
I don't know. I suppose that they've probably patched. I mean, if you look at some of the other larger folks running Spark. They all actually have kind of their own independent branches of Hadoop. And so handling Mesos, accessing HDFS is probably not a big deal to them. You know, Yahoo talks a lot about using Spark. We all know that they have their own branch of Hadoop. Facebook as well, own branch is, last I heard they had close to 200 branches of Hadoop. LinkedIn, again, several branches of Hadoop, correct? Right? So I can't speak to that. I can say they probably augmented either HDFS or augmented Mesos. Again, not something that I can speak in depth about because. Spark?
Yeah.
It's the standard Apache branch.
It
links against.
Yeah,
it's standard. You can go pull it straight from the repos or straight from the download side and run it. That runs fine. You actually have a couple more options because of the uniqueness of the MapR file system, but yeah, the version that we have in our repos is same. Just like everybody else, we link against our own version of the Hadoop jars, but that's what everybody else runs, so.
Hello, Mike.
How
you doing? I have a question. Is there anything specific about the integration between Spark SQL and M7 in this case are HBase in general, or is it standard Hive HBase type of integration?
Yeah, so that's a good question. No, there isn't anything special. The NoSQL pieces are standard HBase API pieces that are in Spark, and they work fine with M7. And the Spark SQL pieces, I put Spark SQL here, which is specific. That is not Shark. We'll talk a little bit more about that in futures. But if we're talking about Hive, it's same. It's Hive 12. In fact, what Shark does is it actually acts to link to your local install of Hive to build and run. So if you're running Hive 12, I think it'll run with Hive 11 as well, or at least it used to. I don't know if the 1.0 release will run with Hive 11 or not. I haven't tried it. Runs with Hive 12, fine. That I've done. And so quickly and easily can go out. Now, the interesting piece is the ODBC pieces for Shark don't seem to be quite flushed out yet. we were working with Databricks. Everybody in here familiar with who Databricks is? So they're the commercial support organization for Spark. They're actually the organization, no matter who you kind of work with Spark on, whatever distribution, Databricks is the company that's kind of stepped up and raised their hand to say we'll support it. It's actually primarily the guys out of AmpLab that wrote Spark. So you should feel pretty comfortable with those guys. Great group of guys. Very busy right now. May not be their most responsive. So just keep that in mind. But yeah, the ODBC pieces, just like everybody else, we're all using Simba to write our ODBC drivers just because of the licensing issue that goes along with working with something like ODBC. So those are coming from Simba, and those last I checked were not well home. We'll go with well home. So there's still some work there to get them to be up to par with these. Now, what's interesting is, even though we saw some idiosyncrasies, I'll call it, with these Simba drivers, MicroStrategy did just announce, actually Databricks just announced MicroStrategy as a validated partner on their website. So I don't know if that's MicroStrategy maybe using a special connector and querying DAGs directly with a MapReduce paradigm or what that is. But my assumption was that they were going to be using Sharp, but I can't speak to that for sure. You could probably certainly call your local MicroStrategy sales guy. He'd probably fill you in. So anyway, this is the architecture slide, and we'll bounce back to this here in a bit. So log file enrichment. There is no good pictures for metadata. So you got the near Metallica ripoff. Keep this quiet. I'm not sure if Metallica will sue me for it. I hear they're a little touchy about that. So anyway, log file enrichment. Why enrich my log file data? I could talk about an example, but is anybody in here doing log file enrichment? Want to share theirs? So nobody's doing enrichment, or everybody's shy. All right. So some of you know me and know that I came out of the information security space. And I actually worked for a while with Dell SecureWorks, and before that was kind of an independent journalist for security. And you know, log file enrichment is something kind of near and dear to our hearts. We've been doing that kind of thing for many, many years. You also see it a lot in web crawlers, right? That's actually their thing. They go out and get a URL, and then everything else they do to that URL is essentially enrichment, right? How many people are linking to it, how often it's referenced, et cetera, right? So what you're doing with log file enrichment is you're taking any standard JOLO log file, picture a firewall drop. Does everybody know what I mean when I say a firewall drop? So somebody comes in, they hit the firewall says, you're not allowed in on that port. I'm gonna log your IP, what port you tried to access, and what time, and I'm gonna drop that, right? And any other pertinent information they can maybe pull out of that. More aggressive firewalls can actually even do, you know, enrichment right there. They may actually do a trace route back to the IP at that time to see if they can identify any additional information they want to post to that log. Anyway, when you get into the security infrastructure, IDS, IPS, those types of things, you're going to aggregate all these logs together. You're going to rip through these logs with a process that's going to come through them and say, okay, this firewall log came from a Cisco firewall, so when it says it performed this type of drop for this reason, it actually means this. And we'll put that in a column. Take the IP, and it most likely will geolocate the IP, right? And all those little iterations, all those little steps that it's doing to say, this is the log, but this is the real context behind it, that's enrichment, right? So we do that a lot in information security. Massive thing that you're seeing, especially like when you're at like Symantec or even Comcast nowadays with it. You know, they're pretty good security hounds, believe it or not, even though their support may not be greatest, they really do a lot behind the scenes for their customers. They do a lot of enrichment on some of those drops of data that they're getting coming through their firewall. So some of the pieces that you would see here in this use case, I actually came up and out of from past years in information security, nothing current. But the big thing about doing this log file enrichment is it's typically pretty heavy throughput. Right? So, standard JOLO company maybe has 5,000 square feet of data center space, albeit that's kind of a smaller company. What do you got? 3, 4, 5, 800, 1,000 servers, each of them producing logs, every single application producing a log that's running on them. By every single application, that could be the firewall on each box, the database on each box, the Tomcat server on each box, the one of the 16 different apps running on top of the Tomcat server on each box, right? So you can see how these logs kind of stack up pretty quickly, right? And log file aggregation is actually a pretty big business. Anybody familiar with the Elk stack out there? Yeah, so a whole little kind of cottage industry springing up to kind of do log file management enhancement. The Elk stack, actually, great little stack, Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana, great little kind of tool set if you've got, you know, some low volume type log file enrichment you want to do. But what you're going to do is, or what we see with Storm is people are actually using that streaming API to pull those logs in, and then once they pull them in, they're actually pushing them into a NoSQL store. OpenTSDB, anyone for that one? Dropping a whole lot of names tonight, sorry about that. So OpenTSDB is a pretty common, or I should say common, it's a pretty well-known tool for kind of stashing log files into HBase. HBase is a great space to stick log files just because of sparse data matrices and a columnar store and adaptive metadata. That's probably another conversation for another day if you guys, again, want to invite me back. And so what they're doing with the Spark API is they're able to bring these log files in streaming, and they can stash them directly into HBase, right? Great space, place to store them. But the streaming API for Spark is great because it allows you to dynamically scale, right? And if you're, say, a bank, and there's a flare-up in the Middle East, and this is a true use case, actually, a flare-up in the Middle East, and a local hacking contingent decides that the U.S. is funding the counter-revolutionaries, they could sick their cyber war dogs on you, and the most common place for those guys to attack is a bank. And so these banks need that capability of being able to adaptively scale out that ingest component, right? Because at any point in time, their retail site can be, you know, slammed by quite a few people doing malicious things. And it may be malicious, it may be denial of service, maybe distributed denial of service, but all those logs still need to be captured and parsed through so that they can then later take corrective actions, right? Or adaptive real-time actions. Again, Spark makes it easier with the streaming API. Spark's streaming API actually has a sliding window feature, which is pretty specific to streaming APIs. And I don't know if anybody in here has used much of streaming APIs, but a sliding window feature basically gives you the ability to slide a window along and say, okay, at any point in time, the specific streaming interface is gonna have this window of data, last 5 minutes, last 8 minutes, last 12 minutes, whatever, right? So at any point in time, you can query the last 5 minutes, or you can query the last 10 minutes. And that's, for Spark, it's a nice, quick and easy setting to set up. Sliding windows in action are actually very, very complex. In fact, there was a company that Cisco recently bought. I can't remember the name of the company, but that's exactly what they did. They did actually a streaming SQL product. And there was a whole white paper that came out of, oddly enough, I believe it was Berkeley, that talked about the sliding window concept in computer science, how complex it is to accomplish that sliding window. Well, with Spark, that sliding window is already there. So you don't have to worry about it. And it's actually a feature that on non-open source software, people are paying quite a bit of money for to be able to hit or query or act on the last 5 minutes of data in those logs. You can easily dump data out of the Spark Streaming API with Hive Shark to dump it into HBase or dump it into files, however you want. And again, the NoSQL connectors into HBase, right? So any of the component pieces here you could actually use in conjunction with each other, which is pretty common. I've got some folks who are dumping into HBase with Hive and Shark, and then they're actually doing queries on HBase in the direct HBase API, and then when they're pulling data back out, they're also allowing other people to query with just Shark. Does that make sense? So back to the picture here. Now we filled in a little bit more, right? We've established that we're gonna be ingesting firewall logs, web application logs. I probably should have explained that earlier, web application logs. and then just straight application logs. Now, in let's say the context of a bank, you can kind of see exactly where this is coming from. The retail website is obviously going to be protected by a series of firewalls. Their specific retail applications are going to be protected by web application logs. Now, web application logs are going to be coming from essentially an advanced firewall. It allows you to do what we call deep packet inspection. So you, the logs coming out of the web application firewall, while they're lower in volume, they're typically much deeper in context, right? And then the application logs, again, these are actually usually, from what I've seen, higher in volume, but lower, higher in context as well, right? So that ability, again, to fan out that streaming API, push it across the cluster, and then drive the ingest, pretty important. In this case, they're actually pushing straight into a persistent store. HBase makes a great persistent store, M7, great persistent store, same, right? And then, like we said in the previous slide, they're using the NoSQL tools and the Spark presentation layers to query those, right? The enrichment piece comes in during the Spark layer, where they're actually reaching out. We've got one company, one bank, that has a guy who's completely on an innocuous list, and he actually hangs out in all those high-end hacker chat rooms, et cetera. And basically his job all day is just to populate an internal repository or internal database with knowledge of zero days, which is an exploit that recently got released, adaptations to zero days, so a zero day that was released before that people maybe have a patch for, but now there's an adaptation to it to allow people to do an exploit, or even just new scanners, new concepts and scanners and ways that people are going out and trying to actively find libraries that people may be utilizing to find exploits. And so he posts this all internally. Known exploits database is what would kind of capture that. Now, one second for us.
One of the things with HBase is to put HBase for M7 because you can do HBase and you can get classes.
So his question was, when I talk about HBase, am I talking about HBase or am I talking about M7? For me, while I recommend M7 because you'll keep your hair, not as important to some people in the room as others, the APIs, while there's subtle differences, you can kind of use them interchangeably. Now, when you start to get to scale, especially when we're talking about streaming ingest, when you're talking about, say, 500,000 inserts a second, you have to be a pretty polished HBase guy to handle that.
More about the question, how do you do your deployment? There can be a Spark plus to separate your
HBase. Oh, okay, I see. Yeah, he's asking about the kind of the tenancy of it. And to answer that question for us, they're all on the same physical file system for MapR, so we'll call it the same cluster. But yeah, if you're running HBase, you may want to confine it to a separate subset of nodes and let Spark run a different subset of nodes. So for most people, that would be, but for people not using MapR, that might begin to look a lot more like a Lambda infrastructure.
It becomes very painful because now you have network communication going back and forth.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And so for us, it's all actually in the same cluster.
For example, we are using cloud in our distribution.
Okay.
So in our case, so we suggest to have Spark on certain nodes in the cluster and then the rest of the nodes with the HBase.
So he said they're using Cloudera and he wondered if I suggested to have HBase on certain nodes in the cluster and Spark on other nodes. I suggest that you use MapR, but in lieu of that, yes, I would keep them separate. And primarily the reason is Spark is going to want to use as much memory as possible, and so you're certainly going to be doing some LRU poisoning, either HBase or Spark. And while Spark has some nice LRU pieces, you don't want to be poisoning each other. You're just going to get crosstalk not necessarily network comm issues, but you're going to be yanking stuff in and out of memory. So you kind of have to keep them isolated. And you can, it's easy enough, even if you are using plain old HBase, to deploy HBase to an isolated subset of nodes. Lorenzo over here can help you with that. Can you help? He's an HBase guy.
So actually, we are using M7. I can speak with it. It's very easy to use. In a couple of days, you can learn it, and you can use it. And no need actually to be very smart in terms of maintenance because it's iterative. So there is nothing special. Wait.
Can you repeat what he said for everybody here?
I don't work for MapR.
So Slim over here said that he recommends using M7. Super easy to get up and running with, very easy to use. And he's right. I'll be honest. It's just a lot easier.
So how much
M7?
Sorry,
what's that?
How much are you paying?
Pizza.
Actually, I don't eat pizza.
See, there you go. There you go.
Yeah, maybe you look for something.
Non-paid spokesperson.
I can tell you an example that we have basically the production database on M7, and we just change the directory underneath it, and you don't need to do anything. Now, when you go query it, you just change the name. That's basically it. You don't need to do anything. While it's running, you can add a new current family, you can change things, it's unbelievable. You should test it to find out.
Okay, go on.
I'm just going to sit back and let it happen.
Yeah, I know.
Thank you, Slim, very much. I appreciate it. I do. So with conventional Hadoop, not super Hadoop, you would definitely want to separate those out just to primarily prevent the memory poisoning. And even in our case, with MapR, we're going to run, we would run M7 on all the nodes in the cluster, we have topologies. We have special magic that allows us to kind of isolate those workloads as well. And on a high ingest, we're going to do that. So that's what will work out. So in the streaming infrastructure, though, what you're going to be able to do is kick out queries, right? So you can kick out queries to a framework that's maybe known exploits, and what you're actually going to end up doing is all these known exploit pieces. Yeah, I'm going to work on the other side of the room for a little bit. Slim's been great, but maybe I'll find another Slim over here. So the known exploits pieces, the blacklist GeoIP, those data sets actually sit inside your cluster. In fact, they're actually lifted up and living in memory inside your Spark cluster. So now you can do near-time interactive queries of this data, and you can enrich those log lines as they come in, and then dump them right into your NoSQL persistent store, right? And so now you've got the capability of when you need to present that with a NoSQL tool, or a SQL presentation tool, or you want to do machine learning and produce some vectors, you've got the capability of quickly and easily accessing that, and it's stored in a persistent store that can handle the high volume of ingest. So SQL mixing with machine learning. This is new. This is something that I literally just started seeing as people started getting more comfortable with Spark. It's not necessarily a new use case, but the way that they're doing it is quite different. And so what you're actually doing is you've got the native machine learning library, MLib, in Spark, right? You've got near-time access to ad hoc SQL queries using Shark. And you've got the R and SQL in the same place, right? So those three pieces that Spark enables are what kind of leads this kind of unique data set piece. And because it's in memory.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
You need help with your phone?
No.
We're at Nokia, they probably offer support. Is it running Windows? There's a couple of Microsoft guys here.
Nokia doesn't do it.
Oh, touche, my bad. You can do bigger than in-memory map produce, right? And that's kind of more core to the machine learning piece than the actual SQL piece, though can very common run into the SQL piece. So the uniqueness here is with R, you have these kind of, I call them math leads. They seem to like that terminology when I run into them. They sit down across the table from me and I'm like, so you're the math lead. And they smile. So that's about all you can ask for. Any math leads in the room? There we go. Two. Yeah, Slim, you better raise your hand. I know who you are. Nobody else is going to cop to it. There we go. All right, guy with the beard. In with that. So anyway, what we had before was people who were doing R typically would have to go out and they'd say, okay, I've got this great new algorithm, I'm super excited to try it, but before I can do it, I have to go out and run a 29-hour query on my Greenplum infrastructure, or a 39-hour query on my Netezza infrastructure. Dang. And immediately the DBA guys would come back and say, you know what's even worse? I'm not gonna let you run the query. And so, hence comes in Hadoop, right? Hadoop came in and said, oh, you run the query in Hive. And the guy's like, all right, great. So now I can run the query in Hive. And maybe I do. Maybe I run the query in Hive, and if my company's nice enough to me, they've invested enough in infrastructure, and I get the query back in, you know, maybe a few hours, which is quite feasible. I've seen this, 39-hour queries on a standard enterprise data warehouse, scraped down to maybe a couple hours on Hadoop. Quite feasible. And then they're able to take that and run it in R. And they've got this two very disjoint processes, but they're now able to do it and accomplish it. What Spark has allowed them to do is mix that up, do it all in one place. And right now, it's still a little separated, but not quite that much. With R, they've got access to actually mllib and Spark R, so they can handle and access all the great features that they want in R, and then they can also mix in some of the mllib pieces, and they can do that in a highly parallelized fashion to a certain extent. R is not quite as flushed out on top of Spark, or I think they call it Spark R, as they'd like it to be. They're still working on it. Same thing with Python. There's an actual lineage there that I'll talk about later. But R is there, and it's quite functional. So somebody else, did you talk about R earlier? Somebody said they installed Revolution R. So yeah, there's a lot of R users out there. So what this allows you to do is write one script, do that data pull, and run some sort of machine learning or advanced modeling algorithm in R right on top of that all in one place. Now it's a little bit still disjoint today because you do still have to use Shark today to do this. But we already have people experimenting with Spark SQL. And is anybody in here, was anybody actually, there was a webcast on it about a week and a half ago. Did anybody make that webcast? Yeah, probably an industry insider thing. So Spark SQL is being developed. It's actually going to be a much more fuller, richer SQL context, and it's going to be like a SQL 99, possibly SQL 2003 standard. And what you're going to be able to do is inline in R, inline in Scala, inline in Python, you can actually just, it's actually a little SQL function. It's like, you know, PySpark.SQL, and you write your SQL query in there, and it creates all the RDBs and DAGs for you when it brings that data back. So now you can kick right through it. You're ready to kick right into your next piece of your data flow. So all in one program, you can do that entire data flow now that used to take many, many tools, right? Back in the old school MapReduce days, right, when we were using things like Oozie to kind of chain these things together, or maybe Oozie and Scoop, now you can do it all in a single place, all in one spot, all in one program, all managed and scheduled by one piece, and it's going to run in memory, so it'll be quite a bit faster, right? So kind of interesting. Oh, go ahead.
So does it convert internally into a Scala program, or what happens when you run the Spark SQL on the computation layer? What happens in the background?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So it kind of goes fundamentally, you know, what is Spark SQL? Spark SQL is you're exactly right. It's going to convert that SQL query, and hopefully now it will be like a SQL, like I said, 2003, full SQL 2003 query, into a MapReduce job that it can then run across the RDBs that are in memory, that are either in memory or need to be lifted up into memory. And as you guys get into the API, you'll see how there's ways to pin certain data sets to memory, with the caching feature, and how you can let certain the features be managed by DLR review, and you can actually tell certain data sets to be stage 2 disk intentionally, right? And so that's exactly what it will do. We'll generate the MapReduce task and run it across the RDBs. And again, it won't be limited to what can fit in memory. In fact, isn't already limited to what can fit in memory. There is some limited support in the, let's say, the alpha or beta branch of Spark that's out there. For Spark SQL.
How Spark decides what to keep in memory and what in hard drive?
And so it has an LRU by default that will least recently used, that will stage stuff to disk as it becomes unused. But that is if you tell it, if you don't define anything, right? It'll default to using this LRU paradigm. If you specify, you can specify anything be cached or kept in cache. And there's all sorts of kind of great API extensions onto how you want to manage that, right? So definitely something that's worth looking into, but explicitly you're going to say keep this in memory or just let the LRU manage this for me.
Is this major differentiator with Lambda, the fact that you can actually handle the big joints?
Spark is fundamentally not just SQL. Spark is way, way more than that.
I mean Shark.
Shark. Shark specifically, that is one of the differentiators. There's probably more to some people and probably less to others. That is certainly one of the reasons that the customers that we have that went with Shark, because they did in fact test Impala beforehand. Impala worked, ran their queries okay, but when they got to bigger queries, it couldn't run the bigger queries. Right? So that is one of the reasons that people are making the decision for Shark instead of Impala.
Covered
it. So I recently had a customer who's been a customer of ours for a while, and they're big R users. And they came to me and said, Mike, we're so excited about this feature. And what they actually do is they have a fairly large sets of tables, and they're pulling data directly out of the tables with a Spark MapReduce task and lifting it up into RDBs separate from the HBase, because the HBase is actually a production use case. And then they're doing their kind of advanced data products creation with R on top of Spark. In this use case, the kind of context would be, again, what have we done so far to kind of review? We brought the logs in, we brought them into Spark Streaming. We're reaching out in Spark Streaming to these different data sets that are being presented by Spark to the Spark Streaming application to do the enrichment, right? This, by the way, doesn't necessarily have to be all data sets that sit on top of Spark either. There's actually quite a few known blacklists, and I wouldn't recommend doing them with GeoIP, but maybe known exploits, where you do kind of a nudge type framework, where you're reaching out to the web to do your enrichment. There's quite a bit of that type of enrichment going on, specifically with log files. So I don't want you to think that you have to be hosting these enrichment tables inside the cluster. Now, if you host them inside Spark, the benefit is you've got kind of an idea of an SLA, right? So if you've got 500,000 log lines coming in, you know about how long it's going to take to process those log lines. When you start kicking out HTTP queries to do enrichment, things can get a little bit dicey, right? So that's why, in this use case, for simplicity, I keep them all hosted here. So what we're doing, we're enriching, we're landing that into the persistent data store, and now we've actually moved all the way over to kind of these two blocks right here, where we're running the SQL, we're pulling in the data, we're getting our data sets, we're getting the enriched pieces of our data sets. We're using MLlib and SQL to generate vectors, and now inside MLlib, we're going to start running some machine learning on top of that. Right? So with that machine learning, we can do k-means type modeling and start generating cohorts for like a recommendation type use case. You can do random foresting and random tree. You kind of go down that same type of concept, Bayesian modeling, which again would be somewhat towards the recommendation case. And one can argue that anytime you're doing machine learning and you're spitting an answer back out to somebody, you're making a recommendation, regardless of what you call it, right? But the random foresting, random treeing pieces, I shouldn't actually go that far. Those are still pretty tough to do in a MapReduce paradigm. You're not going to see those in MLlib yet. There is talk about bringing those in. And kind of turning the screws on MLlib, right? Every piece of Spark is in very active development, so I recommend everybody check back frequently. But the pieces that are there already, if I remember correctly, they feel pretty confident in their Bayesian pieces. They feel pretty confident in their k-means capabilities. If you're familiar with the type of processing that you might do in genomic applications, anything in genomic applications is actually already in MLlib and typically works fairly well. And that's because of the kind of lineage of Spark itself coming out of AmpLab, Berkeley being a fairly advanced genomic institute, and Adam, which we'll talk about later, so I'll just leave it at Adam. So anyway, now we're starting to generate these recommendation models out of Spark and MLlib. Now, again, your favorite language, right? I mentioned earlier that I had people mixing the SQL and R. That's where my math leads are today. But I can tell you I'm already seeing a pretty strong contingent of Python users who are pretty excited about using Spark and Python. And this Spark, the PySpark API is actually a little better flushed out than the R API today. So the recommendation engine piece is exactly what I'm getting to next. Why do it? It's a recommendation engine. Enough said, right? Everybody, this is kind of where everybody tries to get to. Now, this is not specific to Spark. Everybody that I know of today, all my customers, that's where they're headed. They all want to get to, at some point, whether they recognize it or not, some sort of a recommendation engine. So this is getting, you know, as far as you can get today, this is pretty far down the road, right? And in some of my customers, I've seen customers who picked up Spark, and because they didn't necessarily have the talent or the headcount for the other frameworks to do this in multiple frameworks, they weren't getting very far. They were maybe getting to doing some enrichment, but you know, fairly quickly after picking up Spark, they were able to move quite a bit further down the road. They were kicking stuff into MLlib. They were getting recommendations back. Now, I won't speak to how good the recommendations were, but they were getting recommendations back, right? And so it's all an iteration. It's all kind of a pickup, right? So for them, it allowed them to quickly and easily move down this route. Now, I put Mahood up here just because, you know, Ted done a number of MapR teams since the beginning, right? And I don't know how much Ted wants me to say about it, but Mahood, the MLlib guys over at Spark, or maybe talking a little bit, and they're getting cozy. I don't know what they're planning on doing, but there is talk there about doing some work together. So we'll have to see what comes out of that, but definitely something to pay attention to. ETL and enrichment's happening in the same place. The data is all sitting there. It's all ready to roll. Iterate on it right there with MLlib. You're not jumping out of a framework and jumping back in. You know, if Ted were here, he'd be telling me that, you know, it's very easy to do a pretty simple recommendation engine with Pig and Mahoop. It's even easier with Spark, right? All the pieces are there. You're working in the same framework, working with the same APIs, working with the same data sets and operators. Very quick and easy. You're doing the MLlib training on the same cluster. A lot of places that I've seen, especially if they're using the NoSQL store, are happy to move data in and out between clusters, or because their machine learning training is so hungry, they feel like they need to move that off to a separate cluster. With Spark, obviously you can overrun one with the other doing ETL while you're trying to do the machine, MLlib training or the machine learning training, but it's quick and easy to accomplish in the same place, and it's much more highly optimized. The ETL is much faster on Spark, and the MLlib pieces or the machine learning is much faster. So altogether, you're getting an overall optimization, so it's much easier to accomplish these without having the kind of in-depth grid computing resources. You can kind of dig into the cluster and figure out what's going on. And then also because of that in-memory component piece, the really important piece to recommendation engine, and in fact, the place where we see most people falling down, is trying to figure out how to serve those recommendations back up in kind of a meaningful way. They're able to generate the recommendations, but once they have those cohorts, let's call them, they're not really sure, well, how do I put these in the hands of a web application so that they can tell people what books to buy or what movies to watch, right? Well, with in a lot of cases before, when we were using something like, let's say, Pig and Mahoop, we'd actually kick those out and land in the Solr. Absolutely feasible to do with Spark, quick and easy. It's right there in the APIs. You can use great Python APIs to interface with Solr or Elasticsearch. But you can actually just store it right into the in-memory database, or using a NoSQL store or a SQL data store right into Spark as well, and host it right off that same cluster. So now it's flexible, it's dynamic, you have a quick and easy way of pushing it out to maybe an existing framework that you're using to serve up those recommendations, Spark or Solr or Elasticsearch. Or you can, if you're net new, maybe you just want to do it all in Spark because, hey, it's one framework and I'm not going anywhere else, right?
So if you are using R, in this case, it will be easy to expose the result of your recommendation using deploy R, which is the web service API. So that's a way to do it.
Ah, there you go. Deploy R,
yes.
Using R.
Yes.
Quick and easy way of exposing your recommendation.
Exactly.
I've not ever used it. So
yes, I'm using it.
Pretty nice.
Yes.
There's also the Spark R library that's coming. If it's not already.
The Spark R, yeah, the Spark R library is already there. So I don't know, maybe with Spark R, you can do the deploy and you'll be able to deploy this straight from Spark
yeah,
as well.
Yeah, deploy R is a controversial feature of React, maybe to say that, for RRE, Revolution R, right? So that's kind of like how you expose the result, because in this case, if you are using instead of Mount, if you are using R, Enterprise R, the result of your recommendation, you can easily, very easily expose them to a web service API.
Very nice. We're going to have to get you a shirt with a lot of vendor patches on it.
I have to come from
So, you get sponsored by Revolution Analytics and MapR. Start looking like a race car driver walking.
You mentioned at the beginning of this meeting is community, right?
So absolutely.
I'm saying this for free in case somebody has this problem of exposing the results of this.
Have you used the deploy R in any scalable fashion yet? Do you know how well it scales? Is it meant to scale, or is it just, you know?
Not yet in a scalable way, but already I think.
All right. Well, hey, that's a great piece for prototyping, if nothing else. Use case recommendation engine. Now we're to the recommendation engine piece. And so we're kind of over into, we've ingested, we've enriched. We're moving in and storing on our persistent store, and now we're presenting. We're using MLlib to take the presentation out of the persistent data store and create the recommendations. And then those recommendations can be stored directly in this Spark layer as well. In fact, they kind of get exposed in something very similar to the tables that we're using to enrich, right? And then you can actually ingest those with a MicroStrategy, a Tableau, or a ClickView. Not exactly easy to use. Maybe ClickView, I don't know. None of these are really set up to do the recommendation piece well, just because it's kind of an unconventional NoSQL type of presentation that it typically manifests as. But depending on how you design these, you could use it in any one of these three. But the way I've typically seen it used is in kind of more of like a D3 or Node.js type of presentation to do the rendering. And then you can, obviously, on the back end of that, create the monitoring, reporting, data products type pieces with it.
So minus the reporting, minus the recommendation, you have these all in the front plan. They are not also in here. But it's true that you have it all. If you show F again the layer, you have that streaming already built in.
Yep.
You have also the communication with the Hadoop. And you have the reporting built in.
And you know, Splunk has Hadoop connectors. If that's what you're looking for.
Is this recommendations relate anyhow to autocomplete feature?
Sorry, what was the question?
In web, you have autocomplete feature when you type something, you have the hints. Are these recommendations discussed related somehow to autocomplete feature or not?
So they could be. You would have to do a little bit more wrapping for that. If that's what you're looking for, I would actually recommend using a Solr, because it does actually include that feature. It's built into Solr to do kind of an autocomplete feature. Are they related? No. Can they be used in conjunction with each other? Absolutely. In fact, I just did a demo last week for a customer where I shot the data in through Solr streaming into the M7 persistent store, and then actually exposed it out through Solr and also through the regular HBase API. And so absolutely something that's capable. And when I went to interface Spark with Solr, I used the scene libraries for Python and just imported them to kick my data out and also do commits from Python back into Solr. Make sense? If you want, I don't generally host a lot of code on GitHub because I'm not a coder by training, so most of my code kind of looks like kids scribbling with crayons. But you're always welcome to email me or hit me up, and I can maybe go for a cleaned up version where I save the lines or something like that. So as I said in the beginning, the use case kind of builds, right? What we're seeing today is a lot of people looking at Spark for this ingest and query piece, right? They're going to be using streaming to ingest. And by that, I mean they are going to be using streaming to ingest. A lot of the customers are moving away from other framework tools for ingestion and moving to Spark. And the best answer I've gotten to the question of why, I wasn't always an architect at MapR. Before that, I was running production infrastructures for everybody from IBM to some of the pop shops in town. So if I had a tool that worked, I was hesitant to move away from it. So of course, when they said they were moving away from tools they had been using for a year or 2 years, I asked why, and they said, I just want to do everything with one framework, one tool. They were tired of the animal farm. So they are going to be using it for ingestion and then driving to query with Hive. And like I said, we've got a couple of customers already in production with that today. They're working on doing, they're actually already doing the enrichment and query piece today. And they will be rolling out, both of the customers actually will be rolling out later this year, a ingestment enrichment with query and serving recommendations from that query. And I assure you almost everybody in this room will be touching that. I can't tell you who the customer is, but I can assure you almost everybody in the room will be touching that recommendation at some point. So vaguely and anonymously, you'll have to tell me if you feel like anybody's doing better recommending stuff. And we'll see if we found the company. Spark is flattening the curve, right? That's what I'm seeing. People are picking up Spark. It's awesome to use. You can literally run it on a netbook, right? You have a netbook that runs Linux or Windows. It's super easy to pick up, super easy to get going with. You have people who already know Python, you have people who already know R. Scala, I thought this would be a pretty intimidating piece to the whole puzzle. It turns out, and I had worked with Scala in the past, and so I was like, Scala's not too ugly. Again, for a guy who likes to color outside the lines. But a lot of people aren't having a problem even picking up Scala. And what we'll see with the release of Java 8 is that Scala piece, and I don't know how many people in the room have installed Spark, but there's kind of this tough part where you gotta have the right version of Scala and the right version of Spark, and then you do a little chicken sacrifice and everything starts to work. That's gonna go away with Java 8 because the Scala piece is actually gonna become more native into Java. So you'll have that functional type paradigm that Scala provides built right into Java, and you won't have to worry about that piece as much. So again, driving towards simplicity, right? And again, one framework, less data movement. People are not moving data between clusters or even between nodes in the cluster to kind of keep and define that data access. And then they have access to their preferred language. I was shocked. Not a single person has mentioned when's Ruby coming to Spark. Right? We have this in Chicago, and I'm gonna make the tight pants joke because I don't know a lot of people who program in Ruby who don't wear a lot of really tight pants. But even in a room full of people with tight pants, I didn't have a lot of people asking me when's Ruby gonna come to Spark. I think that they've come to the rationalization that Ruby is probably just not a big data language, and so they're gonna have to use something else, and so settling on something like Scala or Python and picking that up is not as intimidating as picking up Java, right? And for the most part, people who struggle with Java struggle with a complex kind of environment of setting it up. And even once you get into that Java piece, if you're using Java with Spark, that's abstracted away. Once Spark is up and running, it's up and running. And so that complex kind of environment issue that you get into with Java is kind of gone as well. I'm a Conan O'Brien fan, I'll admit it. I still watch TBS to get my fix. So future state, I did not mention GraphX at all. Was anybody in here dying to hear me talk about GraphX? One guy? Excellent. Here we go, a few more over here. So GraphX is in there. It's a little odd. I was told that it was in the regular distribution that's shipping. It's in, if you go to the Apache Spark website, it turns out it's there. When the vendors actually worked with Databricks and started shipping Spark on their distributions, they asked them not to put any of the beta code into those distributions. So if you go out and the experience may be different with CDH or with one of the other vendors, but I know certainly for sure they asked us not to ship the Python interfaces, they asked us not to ship GraphX, they asked us not to ship Spark SQL or Spark R or BlinkDB and GraphX. So you get basically with any of the preferred vendors and support today from Spark or from Databricks on MLlib and the kind of standard Spark pieces. You can just go out and download any of them and plug them right in, drop them right into the directory where they belong, and they all work just fine. But Databricks did ask people not to ship them today. GraphX, for anybody who's not familiar, is a graph database. It is not kind of a bulk synchronous parallel graph like Giraffe. Anybody in here work with Giraffe? I thought Lorenzo was going to raise his hand. He totally faked me out. Anybody work with Giraffe? A little bit, yeah. The math nerd. Sorry, math lead. But yeah, so bulk synchronous parallel kind of implies that you're kind of doing a bulk operation to kind of do your graph processing. Whereas GraphX, again, lifts it up into RDBs. You're able to iterate and traverse your graph database in near time. Have I seen a lot of graph use cases? I haven't, but I've seen a few, and I know a couple of successful companies using a graph database today. I know one company in the Fortune 15 that will be deploying a graph application in the not too distant future, not actually using GraphX, they're actually going to be using Titan, I believe. And so they're out there. And you know, a lot of us had a little bit of graph theory in school, classically trained comp sci folks. If not, I do recommend picking up a graph book and giving, you know, graph use cases a look. They're a lot of fun. They can simplify some of your relational use cases dramatically and improve performance a lot. But GraphX is still in development. It's getting there. I see some kind of interesting pieces going along with it. I'm not a graph expert, so I'm probably not the best person to evaluate.
You have a question? Titan's not on Spark, is it?
No. They're actually going to be using. What's that?
Is InfoViz or something?
Sorry.
Titan is InfoViz?
That sounds right. InfoViz for Titan? Is that supporting that this week? They're actually. And Titan actually sits on top of all sorts of stuff. Sits on top of SQL engines, sits on top of NoSQL engines, HBase or Spark. In our case, they're using it on top of M7. So. It's out there being used. It's Neo4j is the only other major one that I've seen, and Neo4j doesn't really scale across nodes, is what I'm hearing, at least what Twitter is saying about Neo4j. I didn't really have time to go out and look at Neo4j as much as I was actually intimately involved with the Titan use case that I'm talking about. But yeah, Graph is going to be.
The only thing I've seen with GraphX documented, and it's very difficult to find documentation for, is Facebook has loaded 1.5 billion edges and vertices into GraphX successfully and worked very well. That's about it.
Yeah, very true. In fact, there is, if I remember correctly, that is mentioned in one of the presentations out on the Apache Spark site. And I believe some of the training sessions that they did at one of the summits includes a sneak peek, I would call it, at GraphX. So it's out there. And do you know, I haven't actually even seen, is there a Python exposure to GraphX yet or no?
I don't know. When I talked to Databricks about GraphX, my comment to them was, boy, the documentation for GraphX sucks. And they said, yeah, it kind of does. It's still, of all the projects that are part of Spark, GraphX is the one that has the least documentation, but probably has one of the most wide appeals out there that people don't realize they have yet.
Yep, that's absolutely true. And so this is actually a pretty good segue. Databricks was out working with us last time we had a big gathering of MapR folks. And the Databricks guys did a presentation in which they kind of laid it out to us. Scala is the first class citizen of Spark, so it's going to be always the most broadest API. Not always the most stable, but it's going to be, well, it should be the most stable, but in its core features, I should say. But it's also going to have the broadest exposure, right? So all the newest, greatest, latest, greatest features are going to be in Scala first. Anytime they do a major release, they're going to try and get all those features exposed in Python. They're still building up that set of engineers who can do the Scala to Python liaisoning. So they're not committing quite yet to that. And then third-class citizen is going to be Spark R on top of Spark. So you'll probably see the broadest set of API pieces in Scala. The next broadest is going to be in Python. And then third-class citizen is Spark R. In fact, their comment to me was, if you know anybody who actually wants to use R on top of Spark, let us know. And so I sent them a list of about 18 companies that I work with that are huge users of R and would love to have the Spark R components. So if anybody else, shoot Databricks a note and say, hey, we'd love to see R, more R support. For C?
Yeah, believe it or not, people still use it.
I still use C. Again, not very well with my crayon. I don't know of any exposure for C just yet, or even
especially if it's considering that it's really PCA and a lot of populations are.
I don't think so. I guess what you could do is kick from Python. If you've got that model, you could kick from Python out to C to do something super.
If
you've got
it.
I don't think so.
There's nothing on the roadmap.
Nothing on the roadmap from them. Hey, you have just as much sway as I do. You can probably pull it. Just email them from your domain at work and tell them this is what you need.
Yeah, it's a little
So that's kind of the lineage of the language. BlinkDB. Who in here has heard of BlinkDB? Yeah, pretty neat, huh? So BlinkDB is kind of, I call it time-delimited queries. So you throw Spark a query, and then you throw it an SLA, we'll say, and Spark's going to return you an answer, and an idea of how correct it thinks it was based on how much time you gave it. And that's BlinkDB. Pretty interesting, right? Because this is something that I came across quite quickly in a discussion I really didn't get into tonight, is the lineage and scratching and plundering that's going on, people trying to move SQL onto Hadoop. SQL works great for a lot of things, but we've already seen it fall on its face in enterprise data warehouses. It's tough. As you get big data sets, relationships are complicated. If you don't believe me, Facebook has a setting for it. But with BlinkDB, you can actually use the total relational tools, kick out a relational query, and you can time delimit it. Right? So the more time you give it, the better its answer is going to be, the less time you get it, obviously the worse it's going to be. And this kind of solves that problem of, all right, great, I got this great big, huge, massive data set that nobody's really ever been able to iterate over before. I can now iterate over it in 4 hours, but I want to have interactive queries. So with Blink, you can have it go out and come back. So this actually fills one of the kind of specific use cases that I've only ever seen ad hoc queries actually used for. And that's for the use case where we're sitting at our desk and saying, hey, I need to write this really long SQL query. I'm going to write a bunch of really short SQL queries to make sure I have all the independent pieces done correctly. It's the only reason, in all honesty, I've ever actually seen a Fortune 500 need ad hoc queries. they're building these longer queries from it. They very rarely actually serve a report from it. They serve a report from great big long running queries, right? So the blank DB piece kind of gives you that capability. Then the OEM piece. Oh, go ahead.
I think one of the more important notes there that it's important for everyone to know is blank DB. If you have the desire to get answers from extremely large data sets with approximate error rates, so plus or minus this error rate, that's what blank DB can do in seconds across massive data sets. There's really nothing else out there for big data to do such a thing in such an easy way.
Anybody have a use case?
So, what is the reason that it gives wrong results in the stipulated amount of time? Less time.
Because it doesn't have time to get through all the data.
So it's just the partial results.
The blink DB piece, if you want to play with it, is actually in a separate Git repo. This is supposed to be mainlined into Spark. Have you heard a deadline on that? Yeah, me neither. Mainlined into the Apache Spark release in the not too distant future. My impression when I talked to Databricks and their folks over there about BlinkDB was that they weren't going to mainline BlinkDB until they had the Spark SQL, or if I ever make a slip, I call it Catalyst SQL because they're using the Catalyst libraries for it. Until they have Spark SQL running, which is going to be their native SQL. Again, it's going to be like a SQL 2003-ish type interface. So it sounds like they're going to delay BlinkDB until they have a what they call the full SQL interface. Lots of OEM activity with Spark. If you go out to their blog, there's several companies that have already talked about being Spark validated. There's a couple companies that are actually already talking about embedding Spark, which is kind of interesting because what we saw quite a few companies go out and kind of start supporting Hadoop. Some of them early on were kicking queries out to Hive. Some of them kind of wrote their native MapReduce layers. You had some companies even like a SyncSort that went out and wrote their own shuffle. They did get fairly involved, but it's not like they were shipping an embedded version of Hadoop, right? Now with Spark, we're actually starting to see companies ship an embedded version of Spark, right? And this impact actually goes well beyond just Hadoop. I mean, Spark, while being part of the Apache Foundation, it's not necessarily just a Hadoop technology, right? It uses a Hadoop cluster, it can use HDFS, but it can use a lot of different things, right? So, it's kind of interesting what use cases may come out of that. Right? I can see, like I said, I've seen people take Elasticsearch and throw it across an array of, 15,000 workstations and actually monitor the Windows system registry with it, right? So you could even see cases like that with Spark. So this is my last slide. I had somebody earlier ask me how we're doing in Chicago. Well, we're hiring in Chicago. We're looking at doing some Hadoop classes. Okay. Go ahead.
Everybody can say that.
Oh. Boris giving me a hard time.
I do know that Amazon is planning to run a Spark as a service.
We talked to them about this. I'm not going to be committal on that either way. We'll have to see. I can. I know some folks at Amazon. I know something's in the works, but I don't know what it looks like yet.
We're all hearing stuff. I don't think any of us have the exact answer yet, but I know there's something coming with it.
Yeah.
There's an audio that I guess they can be modernizing my part with Spark, but something a little bit more negative.
Yeah. Well, and I'm sure when they do release it, they'll have it coupled to S3 very well, and that may be what they're waiting on doing. But yeah, there's noise that something's going on, but like Amazon does, they're keeping it quiet. They were probably pretty focused on launching a phone, from what I heard. So Workshop 88, my haunt. We're looking at hosting some Hadoop classes. So if you guys hit us up on the mailing list and say you'd like a class on Spark or on HBase or whatever, we can facilitate. Apache Drill beta this summer. Lots of great stuff on Apache Drill and the Apache Drill website. encourage lots of you to take a look.
It's a little light.
Apache Drill?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's alive.
It died 2 years ago.
You thought it died 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Did you have a funeral for it?
No, it was here with the funeral.
No, live and well. Lots of folks working on it. Lots of interesting folks working on it, not just MapR guys. And then today is National Making Day.
Hey, actually, wasn't there somebody from Nokia that was actually committing to Drill?
I think you're right. Was his name Boris?
No, I think there's a woman from Nokia that is actually a committer to Drill.
You and your blah blah blah. Did he say I'm sure it was something important?
That's not very nice. Oh, she's no longer with Nokia? Oh, she's with the last search. But she was with Nokia, so Nokia had people committing.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah, there was a lot of noise in there.
There's one thing I've learned about open source over the years. It's don't say something's dead until you bury it. And so that's why I asked if you could throw it at a funeral. But no, alive and well. I'm looking forward to the beta this summer. I'm actually pretty heavily involved. Has some great tooling coming out of the Drill community. And then, again, this is actually the very first National Making Day. There was a maker fair going on today out at the White House. And so, I don't know, for me, I thought what better or more appropriate place to talk about the first National Making Day than a chug event. But happy National Making Day. And if there's any questions, I'll take those now.
But I want to say one thing first.